I love being at the Strand. We always have such a good crowd. So I had the great fortune of coming here last year and talking about my work with the great Phil Jimenez. We had a wonderful time. And the Strand very wonderfully invited me to join some of my favorite people, good friends of mine, brilliant artists and scholars, to talk to you tonight about queer comics. So I'm going to give a very brief introduction, and then I'm going to introduce each person on the panel. And each of us is just going to talk for 5 to 8 minutes about the intersection of queerness and of 17. About how queerness and comics intersect in our work and our thinking. And then we just want to have a conversation with you guys. So there you go. I think it would not be an understatement to say that the last decade has seen a renaissance in queer comics production unparalleled in the history of American visual culture. So alongside the mainstream success of longtime lesbian and gay comics creators such as Alison Bechdel and Howard Cruz, I'm sure most of you have never heard of Fun Home, we have seen the underground emergence of numerous transgender and genderqueer comics artists, including the surrealist fantasy comics of Edie Fake and the butch aesthetics of A.K. Summers. The spectacular introduction of out LGBTQ characters in mainstream superhero comics. The publication of major anthologies of queer comics, including Justin Hall's Eisner Award-winning No Straight Lines, or I think it's a Landa Award-winning book, right? Yeah, which might be better. 4 decades of queer comics, and the award-winning Beyond, the queer sci-fi and fantasy comics anthology, and even the institution of an annual international queers and comics conference founded by the brilliant Jennifer Camper with us tonight and Andre Carrington. And that conference is having its second showing at the California College of the Arts in April, and you're all very encouraged to come. But despite this exponential growth of this incredible queer comics archive, queer theory, understood broadly as the scholarly study of the social and political dimensions of sexuality, has yet to produce a method or a mode of analysis that is attentive to how the forms unique to comics as a medium facilitate or encourage telling stories about non-normative genders and sexualities. In other words, we know that queers are obsessed with comics, but we don't really understand exactly what it is about the form that lends itself to talking about queer lives. So this panel was conceived as part of a larger attempt to develop such a method by drawing on the creative and intellectual resources of queer comics artists, writers, and scholars. And we're going to place an equal weight on the necessary task of exploring, on the one hand, why queer folks of all kind, like many of you in this audience, have been so drawn to comics as a creative medium in the past and in the cultural present, and on the other, how the specific formal qualities of sequential comics art lend themselves to narrating queer lives, loves, and worldviews. So each of us are going to speak briefly about how our scholarship, art, writing, and critical thought has taken shape at the intersection of queerness and comics art. And we're going to use those presentations as a launching pad to talk to you guys. And I want to mention that, you know, our panel participants, this is an extraordinary group of people because we cover a lot of ground. We have amongst us comics writers, artists, and teachers who work across multiple genres, from superhero comics to women's and LGBT comics and autobiography and comedy, people who work in different sectors of the comic book industry and who have also provided extensive training to aspiring comics practitioners. So Phil and Jennifer have also been great teachers of comics. And we also have scholars, myself included, and Maggie, who work across disciplines, including women's, gender, and sexuality studies, media studies, and visual culture. So we encourage you to kind of engage in a conversation with us about all of these questions. So let me give a brief introduction to each person here. Margaret Maggie Galvan is a scholar of contemporary women's visual print culture. She is completing a book titled Invisible Archives of the 1980s, Feminist Politics and Queer Platforms, a book and digital project under contract with the University of Minnesota Press. And this project traces a genealogy of queer theory in the 1980s, American feminist thought through representations of sexuality in visual culture. This is like the kind of book that I die for. She's received numerous awards for this work, and she is currently creating a digital network and maps of Alison Bechdel's participation in 1980s grassroots periodicals, which I have firsthand experience of and is really wonderful. Jennifer Camper is a cartoonist and graphic artist. Her books include Rude Girls and Dangerous Women and Sub Girls, and she edited two Juicy Mother comics anthologies. Her work appears in numerous publications, comics, and anthologies, and has been exhibited internationally. And as I mentioned, she's one of the co-founders of the Biennial Queers and Comics Conference. And last but not least, Phil Jimenez is a comic book artist and writer known for his work on Wonder Woman as a penciler of the miniseries Infinite Crisis and for his collaborations with writer Grant Morrison on New X-Men and in the Invisible. No big deal, like, no, whatever. And he recently finished his run on the acclaimed Superwoman series. So with that, I hand it off to you guys.
This is just to go forward.
So these are my books. The first one is Rude Girls and Dangerous Women, is a collection of comics that I did mostly every 2 weeks in a variety of publications. Sub Girls is what I call a graphic novella, because it's not long enough to be a novel. And then those are my two Juicy Mother anthologies, which are compilations of LGBT cartoonists. In answer to the question, why are queers drawn to cartoons? For me personally, it's because they're cheap and easy. And all the materials you need for comics are small and easy to shoplift. You know, I became a cartoonist when comics was even more of a bastard art form, so all this academic bullshit is kind of funny to me. People can get their, they can get an MFA in comics now, which is really hilarious. But, you know, we just did comics because, you know, that's what was there for us, and I wanted to talk about the world from my point of view. Somehow, insults never produced the expected response from Terry and Roz. Hey, suck my dick, you big butch dyke. Okay, asshole, how about if we beat the shit out of you and teach you some manners? Wait just a goddamn minute. I'm the big butch, I get to You big, ha. Police, there's more to being butch than just size. And there's more to being butch than just leather. Help, please, I'm choking. Shut the fuck up, motherfucker. I mean, I could kick ass in a pink fucking dress. Oh yeah, then how come you always make me squash the cockroaches, huh? Here's the advantages of being a teenage dyke. Hey, let's practice kissing so we'll be ready when we have dates. Okay, I'll be the date. Did you hear about the Jenkins girl? If you get pregnant, Julie, I swear I'll kill you. Hey, Ma, no problem. Now, I don't want you to have any boys over while I'm away. Okay, but can Letitia sleep over? Of course. Thanks for keeping my wife company while I'm out of town. Anytime, Mr. Benedetti. Oh, Gina, would you give me a back rub? How come you're always early for gym class? This is a letter to heterosexuals. Homosexuals are just like normal people, really. They have jobs and spend lots of money from their double income households. They want to join the military and defend their country. They want to get married and raise families. And live in the suburbs and vote Republican and be a part of the great American dream. Excuse me, who hired these two? Get them out of here. They're making us look bad. Heterosexuals, please ignore these disgusting ladies. They have nothing to to do with us nice homosexuals. Please, straight people, please don't look. Don't hate me, I'll be good. Just toss us a few crumbs, please. Damn it, you two have ruined everything. Now heterosexuals will be angry with us. Now they'll never let us be equal. Equal? Who wants to be equal? Yeah, why set your sights so low? In a lot of my comics, I also write about my background, which is half Lebanese. And this comic sort of resulted after being the experience of being in New York after 9/11 and being both queer and Arab. And for a lot of my friends who are also Muslim, it became this really complicated ping pong act. So this is called Who Do You Think You Are? Tell us about yourself. Let's see. Well, I live in New York City. Yeah, elitist, city slicker, intellectual snob, welfare queen. No, I have a job. I worked in the World Trade Center before 9/11, I mean. Ooh, 9/11, you're a victim, you're a hero, bomb the Middle East. You must hate Arabs. Actually, I'm Arab American. My grandparents, terrorist, you hate our freedom. You're a product of a religious theocracy. You're under arrest. You want to oppress women. Never, I'm a feminist. I believe in, ew, hairy legs, you're ugly. Man-eater, anti-sex, anti-marriage. I do want to get married, but they won't let my girlfriend and me. Yeah, lesbians, queers, there are no Arab homosexuals. Dykes, you're a sex pervert. But my girlfriend and I love each other. Ah, hot sex, can I watch? Show us some pictures. Does she have big tits? Want to go out for a drink? Huh, I don't drink, I'm Muslim. Yeah, towel head, she probably has a bomb. A proper Muslim woman should be veiled. There are no Muslim homosexuals. You're a religious fanatic. No, I want to redefine Islam. I believe Islam is a religion of love and human dignity. I believe in peace, justice, and equality. I believe in cross-cultural understanding. I believe that we're not limited by labels like Arab, Muslim, lesbian, or New Yorker. You're an idealist. Get real. No way. Dream on. And that's all for today, folks. Wasn't that fun? Come back again next week when we define a Catholic Mexican illegal immigrant. Most recently, I've been doing longer fictional stories, and this is the beginning of one. It's called Just Another Night in Carbon City. Luckily, I was done fucking the girl when the call came in. I can't even read that from here. she was only a doll I met in a bar, but still, I hate being interrupted. After she left, I called back. The target will be in Carbon City. Make it clean. Carbon City. I hadn't been there in a while. It didn't look any different. A two-bit town lousy with the stench of desperation. I had some waiting to do, and I found a dark place, a dark hole where I could hunker down. It's good to unplug from technology and return to basics. Getting back to nature can replenish the soul. So this is a big, long story about a female assassin. It's very uplifting. And she's kind of having a tough time because she's older and there's younger ones coming up to take her place. But mostly what I love about comics is that when you put words and pictures together, you get something that's bigger. And that's pretty much what I spend my time doing. So thank you.
I'm going to start my timer. When I was asked to be a part of this panel, as I wrote here, I was in a little bit of panic, particularly the past few weeks, trying to assemble talking points for this. because I'm not in any way an academic or a scholar, and I don't pretend to be one. However, I have been doing this, writing and drawing superhero comics, for about 26 years. So if nothing else, I have a bit of experience in this part of the woods, in this neck of the industry. And so my slideshow and my discussion are a little bit about what I think about being a queer creator in mainstream superhero comics. Let's see what I put up here. Anyone? What am I doing?
You broke it.
It's my tie. Okay. What I wrote here, and forgive me, I'm going to use this a bit. When it comes to approaching queer aspects of comics, I personally think about a multitude of things above and beyond the economics of comics, which we can talk about later. I think of the genre of superhero comics itself, which, with its highly colorful, over-the-top, visually fantastical, often bombastic, and overtly sexualized and performative characters, seems decidedly queer to me. I think about the function of story, queer stories, and myths and myth-making. I think about connection to narrative through specificity, particularly these days. I'm really interested in metaphors stacked upon metaphors. And a couple of other things that I think about more broadly when I think about my approach to work and queer-themed work are literally the essence of the divine, gay spirit, as it were, being transferred into this medium. And I think about gay people and queer people as communities of creators and consumers, united by their queerness, our queerness, if nothing else. And finally, I tend to think a lot about superhero comics, particularly because of the genre. I think a lot about war, punitive justice, militarization through entertainment, and the representations of power, and its transformative and destructive effects on gay people and the gay community, whatever that is. One thing to be aware of, I picked up a lot of art for this. Some of it is art that I made, some of it is not, but it's all has impact and is really here just to illustrate some of these things I'm talking about. When we talk about influences, my influences are well documented on Wikipedia, but I'll reiterate them just for clarity. The biggest was being a queer latchkey kid growing up, only child of a single parent, drawn to stories of escape and imagination, especially because I knew I was different. I've often said these stories of escape presented themselves first in unexpected places like museum dioramas or Hollywood studio backlots, but it was truly Wonder Woman and the X-Men, though not in every incarnation, that had the greatest impact on me in terms of my genre sensibilities. Why is this not working?
I pointed right there.
Oh! X-Men. I always say it's a cliche at this point to cite those two examples, but it's really, really true. These characters, if not their books, set the high bar for queering, at least in my definition, of mainstream superhero comics, although not every adventure or creator attached reflects that. So I often say that the desire to live in a world greater than mine, without its confines, to live bigger and bolder, and among other people like me who see the world like me, remain my biggest queer influences and have a huge impact on the sorts of stories I'm interested in and the ones I often like to tell. I just think growing up gay, it entirely shaped my approach and my worldview and the lens through which I tell story and the sort of myths I want to make for queer people. Up next, the worst slideshow ever.
I don't know why you're having a hard time.
I pointed that way.
Ah, sorry, that's just another fantastic example. Like, please push that.
Say cue.
A lot of these are Wonder Woman, obviously, because I tend to think of her as such a queer icon. I wrote a huge essay about why that is, but primarily because of William Moulton Marston, her creator's sort of initial approach to her as a transformative figure and quote-unquote love leader, especially in a time, the 1940s, World War II, where these ideas were actually highly transgressive. So, when it comes to these conversations that I have, and please forgive me while I ramble, I do think a lot about identity and its depictions in mainstream superhero comics. So I think about several questions. Are we as queer people love leaders, like William Marston coined Wonder Woman? As a queer person, is it my job to try to transform the world with my art or just reflect the world I live in? Personally, as a creator, I want to not just provide enforcements for the world we live in, but possibilities for the world as it could be. And yet, I myself am also limited in the scope of my imagination and by my own experiences. And it's actually one of the reasons I'm so enamored of other young queer creators who break down these barriers to imagination, really, and they allow me to rethink the world in a different way. It should be noted, and then I will move on, that all these conversations that we have, that I have in my head about queer representation, about identity, about the divine aspects of being queer, are conversations that occur in a genre, not a medium, but a genre run by very reactive business people out to hit their quarterly numbers for shareholders. I personally think it's nearly impossible to imagine creating and managing queer content in their publishing universes without remembering that even the best intended publishers often make decisions based on money. And I think that's really always important to remember. Let's try this again. Next. X-Men, because they're fantastic. Oh, okay. Woo! Yes, so very quickly, I'm thinking about the queer aspects of superhero genre comics. Again, I realize I'm not sure I have much to add to things I've already said, except to reiterate that as a genre, superhero comics seem ridiculously queer to me. And it's that often it's a ridiculousness I like to play with these days in the comics I create, often in meta-text. At their core to me, superheroes are performative creatures. They are big, bold icons of fantasy and transformation. They are still most often beings who transform into one shape or another. They're usually, that shape is usually glamorous, colorful, powerful. It is a shape that defies traditional norms of behavior, dress, and gender expectation. And these characters often take to the streets in the name of justice, solo, or in teams to transform the world they live in, sometimes through examples of alternatives and sometimes using debilitating violence, and usually while wearing masks, heels, and capes, which I fucking love. I often say that superheroes are drag queens with superpowers beyond the ability to read for filth. And if the Legion of Superheroes is the queer, like, is our future told in queer terms, teenagers fighting entropic nightmares in outer space while wearing space bikinis and man corsets, then count me in. next. Please. Oh, yeah, I mean, like, it just, it's so gay. I have this ongoing bet. I've never had abs, but I'm supposed to actually wear this costume one time to cosplay, and I'm dying somehow to get it. Somebody actually made me a costume, but it was ill-fitting. Yes, and so here, seriously, who can look at a piece of Alex Ross art, one of the great masters of our modern age of comics, and not see the perfect homoeroticized idealization of these heroes? To my knowledge, Alex is not queer, but much of his art embodies all that I think of when I think of queer heroes. It's like he gets it even if he doesn't get it. As a queer creator with a particular voice, I am very, very interesting, again, in tackling these themes, but I'm also a little concerned about what if I do it correctly or incorrectly, and am I prepared for a backlash, especially from other queer people? I'm gonna speed up, because I got a lot. But a couple other things. When it comes to the production of comics, one thing I find myself keenly interested in is queer myth and myth-making. Karen Armstrong, which is a name I think some scholars sort of poo-poo, but actually was profoundly effective to me, suggests that a myth well told is one that makes us think about the world. So, wow. I'm a notorious crier, by the way. In a new way, and it makes us think about our place in it. In superhero comics, Wonder Woman and the X-Men did this for me for decades. It seems to me that in secular society, we tend to literalize myths. We apply scientific values to stories that are metaphors to make them factually untrue as to exploring their universal truths. This is one of the reasons I tend to object to the over-literalization of the mythology of Wonder Woman, because invariably it is never the metaphor being explored, but the literal events of the myth itself. And because we know that these myths are untrue or can't possibly be real, I feel like it often undermines these characters and their worlds. And so it's one thing I think a lot about when I'm creating these stories is the metaphor, the mythology behind them, as opposed to the literal facts as presented on the page. I think that the dangers of interpreting the fantastical literally have also been, keep going, she's one of mine. Gay. Okay, stop. One of the reasons for this literalization has been the success of the billion-dollar blockbuster film industry, which almost requires a literal approach to these characters. Another thing, when thinking about the queer aspects of superhero comics, I think about specificity, the queering of characters, and the desire and need of ourselves to see ourselves reflected in the worlds that we've created. What's interesting to me is that mainstream comic book universes are products of a very particular industry that was straight, white, American, male, and often rooted in religious ideas of virtue and justice, kind of the opposite of the other. And yet, here we are. We're in it. North Star and Aurora. Click through this fast. Estranio. Midnighter and Apollo. Batwoman of the Question. Gravity Kid and Powerboy. Natasha Irons and Tracy 13. Iceman and Romeo. America Chavez. We're finally represented. We're there in mainstream comics. Maybe not in huge numbers, but substantially more than ever before. And I'm left wondering, as a creator, why do we desire to see ourselves reflected in worlds that rejected us for so long? What are we reclaiming? Do we want to see these worlds transformed by our presence in them, or do we just want to be included in them? How queer are these characters beyond having same-sex relationships? Do they work to change the status quo in their universes, tackling institutions that seek to oppress them? Is their mere presence within that universe enough to change the status quo? How do they represent their queerness? And what is queer enough? And finally, when is queer uncomfortable for even queer readers? What is too queer? I could go on and on. I'm not going to bore you. But basically, the other things I do really think about are war, justice, and power, and particularly how queer characters represent that, and what we speak about through queer narrative and how we tackle these ideas. I will say one last thing, that the religious rights war on LGBT Americans, Donald Trump's war on the LGBT community, war in politics of sexual violence, waging war on LGBT topics in individuals and schools, global LGBT advocacy and the new Cold War, these were just things. I literally put in LGBT and war on Google, and these were the first things that came up. The language of war literally envelops us every day. As queer people, we are raised with it. And war, figurative, legal, and literal, is normalized for us. The Kree-Skull War, Thanos War, Secret Wars 2, Mutant Massacre, Operation Galactic Storm, Magneto War, World War Hulk, Messiah War, Chaos War, Ultimate War, War of the Gods, Our Worlds at War, Amazon, Trinity War, Psy War, Dark Side War. The list goes on and on. And I realized that superhero comics were built on this kind of struggle. But I just wonder what that does for us as a community and what it means for our characters to be there and for us to be represented in those struggles. And the sort of stories that sort of buttress our community and transform them, often sometimes in negative ways. And so often as a creator, I think about that, and particularly the way power is presented and the way violence is normalized. And I often wonder, particularly as I get older, like what I have left to say in an industry that seems to exalt in that kind of violence. That was a really heavy ending that I had not intended. If you skip to the end, there's actually a very cute little picture. See, war, sad. War, happy.
Okay, so you guys are amazing. This is a tough act to follow. Thank you guys, it's so beautiful. And these are conversations I've been having with Phil for so long, so it's beautiful to see you talk through some of that.
Sorry, it was long.
I decided to kind of take down a few notes, but to talk kind of freely and openly about some of the things that drove me to write my first book, and then some of the things I'm thinking about in my new work. And kind of the way that Phil ended actually speaks quite a bit to my own evolution as a thinker. So I had the great fortune as a scholar in the last 10 years of my life to write a book that's now in print called The New Mutants, Superheroes and the Radical Imagination of American Comics. And this book came out of, initially, my own adolescent love and identification with the X-Men, of course. And as a young gay Middle Eastern kid growing up in Orange County, California, I remember when I first read the X-Men as a 13-year-old, being bullied in middle school, feeling deeply alienated in this very white, kind of upper class, straight space, feeling deep, immediate identification with characters who were nothing like me. So reading about characters like Storm, one of the first black woman superheroes, feeling immediately that I was connected to these characters. And as I grew older and developed as a scholar, it seemed odd to me that there was a perception that superhero comic books historically were white, masculine, straight, conservative, because that was not what I experienced at all when I read them as a kid. So as I developed kind of my own intellectual sensibilities at UC Berkeley, I began to interrogate where that perception comes from and whether or not I was just like some random kid who happened to experience the X-Men in this way. And that became kind of the beginning of a decade-long process where I tracked the reinvention of the American superhero in the 1960s from a kind of figure of white masculine nationalism to a genetic and species outcast. Something happens in the post-World War II period in the US where the superhero gets radically transformed from kind of Superman, Captain America, Batman, into the X-Men, the Fantastic Four, the Hulk, these mutated, outcast, monstrous figures. And in an era, historically, when monsters, mutants, outcasts, and queers of many stripes were seen as extraordinarily deviant, dangerous, and needing to be contained, superhero comic books were one of the only places in which these characters were celebrated, embraced, and readers were taught to identify with those characters. So the New Mutants basically tracks The New Mutants tracks the variety of figurations of the American superhero that emerged in the 1960s and after. And one of the arguments that I make is that in this period, a wide variety of generally kind of liberal, middle-of-the-road comic book creators who were invested in kind of big liberal ideas like anti-racism, anti-fascism, kind of nominal anti-sexism, had to encounter, I mean, they wanted to believe they were anti-sexist, but they knew nothing about women or gender or whatever. They tried, though. I mean, the Fantastic Four, as I'll say in a second, is a great example of this. This kind of liberal cohort of mostly Jewish second-generation immigrant creators, they began to encounter a new radical countercultural youth generation of readers who began to demand more political claims from their comic books. They basically looked at these creators and said, you've invented this generation of mutants. These people obviously represent a variety of interests, like racial outcasts, gender and sexual outcasts. You have to live up to your own politics. So part of what I argue in The New Mutants is that the superhero essentially transformed into a figure of radical left-wing cosmopolitanism, which is an ethos or a spirit, a democratic spirit of cross-cultural engagement. And we see this in countless ways. One of the ways we see this, I'll go back, is in the formation of superhero teams that are like queer kinship networks or families of chosen outcasts who are not bound together by blood, but by shared values. And through this expansive visual scaling upward, where superheroes now leave ordinary cities, they no longer fight everyday crime, they go out into an uncharted cosmos, and they meet countless alien species. And all of these comic books become about people engaging one another across kind of cultural bounds. So people have seen me, anybody in this room who knows me, I've talked about this image 1,000 times. But this is a very famous image from the X-Men's Phoenix Saga, and it represents this beautiful kind of moment in the mid-1970s when we get this multiracial, multinational cohort of X-Men who are on the left, who encounter this group of this kind of military personnel of an alien empire called the Shi'ar Guard, who are made up of countless species, who are all dressed in disco attire surrounding like a massive disco ball. And in this kind of visual culture, superhero comic books reference directly the visual cultures of a gay and multiracial disco. We see this everywhere. If you read the X-Men in the 70s, even though none of the characters are explicitly gay or lesbian or LGBT, they are unbelievably queer. And the comic book is constantly reminding you of this in the way it absorbs those cultures. So, briefly, I'll say that this book was heavily influenced by queer theory, which I try to describe very broadly as the scholarly study of the public and political dimensions of sexuality and desire. So if we tend to think of desire as incredibly intimate, local, private, queer theory tries to think about the public dimensions of the way desire kind of not only is organized in public collective life, but also shapes the way we interact with other people. And queer theory helped me develop this project in two ways. One was that it allowed me to address the variety of ways in which the alliances, the bonds, the friendships and kinships that post-war superheroes produced were incredibly queer. They thwarted the demands of heterosexual desire. So the idea of marriage, heterosexual reproduction is practically meaningless in post-war superhero comic books. Romances are brief. Long-term collective commitments to family and team are at the center of these stories. And the second way in which queer theory was helpful to me is that queer theory not only explores the variety and range of non-traditional, non-normative, or LGBT erotic desires and attachments, but it also explores queerness as a way of life in which we approach desire as something that is porous and open-ended. And one of the things I argue is that post-World War II superhero comic books were all about eliciting from audiences a desire for people who are not like you. By looking at people who have nothing to do with you, who have different physical morphologies, who are monstrous, freakish, et cetera, and saying, I identify with you. And so my new work kind of extends, The New Mutants is a perfect example of this, an incredibly heterogeneous team that I talk quite a bit about at the end of my book. So my new book is titled Queer Forms, and I'm excited that it's gonna be coming out with NYU Press, my original publisher. And this book builds on my first book by thinking about how popular culture, especially in the era of women's and gay liberation in the early 70s, became one of the sites in which a vast range of alternative genders and sexualities got articulated to mass audiences. So what interests me in this book, and the reason it's called Queer Forms, is this. In contemporary queer and feminist politics, we seem to be stuck in a contradiction between a stated desire on the one hand for legal and political recognition of non-traditional sexualities and genders. We want laws to allow transgender folks to access bathrooms. We want gay marriage. So we want definable legal responses to fixed identities. And then on the other hand, we have a deep attachment to the idea that what is so radical about gender and sexuality is that they're infinitely fluid and formless. And one of the ways that we see this tension play out is in the fact that so many queer people, myself included, want to be represented in media, and every time we're represented or given form, we talk about how much that has failed. Like, oh, it's nobody can understand me. So one of the arguments I make in this book is that the movements for women's and gay liberation of the 1970s, which we tend to look at now as regressive and white and not intersectional and conservative, part of what their genius was, I argue in this book, is that they understood that in order to expand and transform the meanings of gender and sexuality in the modern US, they had to actually give form to a vast range of genders and sexualities. They had to actually produce forms, figures, tropes that could be absorbed by mass audiences. So what I do in this book is I take six key concepts that emerged out of women's and gay liberation. For instance, consciousness raising, or the coming out narrative, equality versus difference, lesbian separatism, And I show how those concepts, which were abstract in nature, got formalized in specific kinds of popular culture. I spend a lot of time in the book on seriality and serialized narrative. And I'm interested in why a form like serialization, the kind of serial installment unfolding of stories or images in comics, were so useful to queer people in the 1970s. So in my fifth chapter, I explore queer uses of sequential comic strip form to articulate or express alternative conceptions of gay sexuality in the 1970s and 80s. And this chapter attempts to understand why queer artists who might not be considered traditional comics producers, people who are not really interested in being like Alison Bechdel, found themselves drawn to the medium of comics for its distinct formal sensibilities, the fact that it is about a visual disjoint between images across space, that it unfolds serially, et cetera. So I look at two innovative uses of comic strip sequence by the queer mixed media artists Joe Brainerd and David Voinarovich. Both artists were New York residents of Lower Manhattan at key moments in the development of contemporary US culture, gay liberation, and the AIDS epidemic, respectively. And each of them had a deep affinity to the comics medium throughout their short-lived but very productive careers in the 70s and 80s. So this is Brainerd. Both artists produced surrealist comic strips. They incorporated comics into their collage and assemblage work. This is Voinarovich. Including seriality, visually disjointed panels, and a combination of text and image. This is one of Voinarovich's most famous combination of text and image, untitled One Day This Kid Will. In the early 70s, Brainerd adopted the classic comic strip character Nancy in a series of over 100 paperworks that depicted her in a variety of alternative sexual and social positions, as transgender, as high on drugs, engaging in anal sex, and much more. And through these imaginative permutations, Brainerd used the serialized character of sequential comics to depict sexuality as a seemingly endless array of unpredictable installments. And I argue that this practice gave material form or shape to early gay liberation's view of sexuality as a playful and open-ended performance of unfolding erotic possibilities. So this seems odd because serial narrative seems so fixed. It seems like a linear unfolding of boxes, right? But in fact, he used the indefinite and unpredictable unfolding of images to model the idea of endless erotic encounters, one after another, after another, after another, in indefinite unfolding. And little more than a decade later, in his graphic memoir, 7 Miles a Second, the artist David Voinarovich and his collaborators, James Romberger and Marguerite Van Cooked, used the visual disjoint between comic strip panels to formally dramatize the experience of social alienation and physical pain associated with being a queer person with AIDS. So their techniques included altering the visual orientation of panels across the page. They create massive panoramas to express the emotional intensity of seeing friends die, of living with the disease, creating massive visual disjoint between images to articulate the feeling of being physically torn apart internally. And so I'm gonna show an image that is a little bit disturbing here. I do quite a bit of an interpretation of this amazing image in which Voinarovich describes the incredible trauma of the loss of his friend and former lover, Peter Hajar. And he says in the narrative, I wish that I could basically knit our blood vessels together. He wishes that he could reclaim an intimacy so close that he could imagine their bodies exploding into one another. And one of the things I argue is that here's a moment in which comic strip form, which unfolds serially, can be used to formally dramatize the intensity of feeling associated with the traumatic losses of AIDS. And it does this through representational density. So the fact that we have so many individual images crammed into one space with the explosion of bodies at the middle kind of recreates this affective intensity. So ultimately, I show how each of these artists inhabited the serialized structure of comic strip visuality to present seemingly intimate and personal gay desires as radically unstable and continually unfolding, so that we think of queerness as a historical force that can never be reduced to any single expression or identity. Here we go.
see if I can get this thing working. We'll see. Okay. Hey, everyone. I got to get to follow all of that. So much fun. Okay, this is me. Let's see. Oh, look, there we go. Okay, so anyway, so what I'm going to be talking about, I'll like, let you marinate on this image for a moment. What I'm talking about today is comics that were produced in gay periodicals in big cities across the 70s and 80s. This work hails from like archival research here in the city and nationally. My goal for this is to entertain you, to curate for you a range of unknown names alongside forgotten works by known names, but also to engage in dialogue about how we might recuperate this work and to what effect. How do we read this work within its queer communities, and how do we decipher these visual politics? So there's going to be an accumulative effect going on. I might say very little about some things and more about other things. So I think we all know who this is, perhaps. So we all know Alison Bechdel, lesbian cartoonist par excellence. But in retrospective accounts of her work, we forget that she discusses that it was her finding issues of gay comics in the Oscar Wilde Memorial Bookshop in New York City that convinced her that she could become a queer cartoonist. There is a prehistory before her, right? And furthermore, this is really important to me. So in No Straight Lines, great anthology, go buy it. I've not been paid to say that, I just love it. But Justin Hall talks about how there's this parallel universe of comics. I'm looking at gay newspapers, and these comics never really get seen elsewhere. A lot of these creators, we don't know their names, especially those who never published in other places. Or even if we do know their names, their stuff is not reprinted elsewhere, including the work of more known figures. So I'm, you know, now we're gonna get into showing you some comics. Here's the true adventures of unsung woman heroes in our troubled times from Gay Community News, the Boston area, New England area publication more widely. This is from 1974. We have the repurposing of the waiter, there's a fly in my soup trope, but everyone's realigned. And so you probably definitely can't read this, but the waitress is a radical lesbian forced to assimilate into society by economic necessity. And the customer is a male chauvinist. And the fly, become like solidarity, and the fly attacks the man and punches out this man, and then it's like, we've now won against fascism. Another unwitting tool of the fascist society bites the dust is what it says at the end of this comic. So this is, you know, I haven't figured out who this is yet. So a lot of these are like open mysteries. So if you know who these people are.
I know how to find out who that is.
Yeah, no, I mean, this is also why I'm, because Jennifer worked on this. Okay, so this is also Gay Community News, 1975, The Layout Crew. The thing I want to say to you about this is it's important to remember that cartoonists publishing comics in these papers were often involved in the layout and production of the newspapers. So we need to remember that when we read these pieces, it affects how we read them, which I'm going to discuss more later. I'm just showing you the strips right now, but it's a really large world of conversations happening on the page, and you know they're doing paste up and they're talking about their hookups, right? Okay, this is from New Jersey. Albatross was this lesbian feminist satire magazine which published the work of cartoonists that you may know, like Roberta Gregory and Mary Wings, but also had like fairly anonymous continuing comic series, including one that lambasted Betty Friedan and Phyllis Schlafly. Betty Friedan was Betty Frypan, and Phyllis Schlafly was Phyllis Shitfly. And this one, who are these roommates who humorously discuss their attraction to women in quippy sound bites. These are some of my favorites. Are you a practicing lesbian? No, this is about as good as it gets. And what do you think of the theory that overcrowding causes homosexuality? I think we should call up a bunch of women and invite them over here. Right? And there's a bunch of these. So it's always the same images, but different like sound bites. Okay, this is someone who published in Albatross, T. Shook. She also participated in Big Mama Rag, which was a periodical out of Denver. And I found letters that she exchanged with visual artist T. Corinne, where she says that her beginnings of making comics were after taking a class at University of Michigan with Gail Rubin, who was a noted sex-positive queer theorist important for the development of queer theory. She's someone who never really publishes outside this world. We don't really know of her, but I've actually recently met the person who started Big Mama Rag, and so now I'm friends with her on Facebook, but we haven't really talked yet, so curious to know more. I'll tell you more when I know more. New York City, Lesbian Agenda 86. The illustrator here is a Native Hawaiian activist. This is, for me, like important because we often don't like talk enough about like queer of color creators. And this sort of lesbian agenda is sort of a takedown of how certain issues are not, are like taken up within lesbian feminist politics. And you have in the very bottom right corner talks about racism. And then there's a whole nother comic, which I won't show you, that talks about like what are white women's role within like racism and like combating racism. But so this is like this, at the beginning of the year, what's the lesbian agenda and sort of taking it lightly. Then I'm gonna move us to someone we do know. Alison Bechdel got her start in Women News. So this is a New York City based thing. Here are some of the covers she did. I wanna, one of the things I wanna say here is for me, comics sort of, when you start to see the work by comics artists in these venues, it's not just comics, it's covers, it's advertisements, it's graphics for articles, it's all these sorts of the comic hand in different forms. And so I'm sort of thinking about like how comics move outside of their panels, outside of their frames into these other forms. Also thinking about, especially, so then Bechdel moves to Minneapolis. Like I'm sort of like a stalker of past Bechdel. Like I know where she lived and when and what her address was. You know, not that I walk by her past Park Slope addresses, I do. But so from 86 to 1990, she worked on Equal Time. She's production coordinator there. So she's directly like working on the layout. But you also get these moments where she's thinking about hate crime. She's thinking about lesbians and AIDS. She's thinking about these things we don't see in her work. Dykes to Watch Out For, which is her long-running strip, is pretty utopic, right? And so, but this is sort of the larger conversation that her work is involved in. This is like the real world politics she's encountering in the day to day. Also, you may not remember that she did a short running strip for 2 years in the Advocate National LGBT Periodical called Servants to the Cause. And it was directly informed by her work on Equal Time and Women News, but also her work sending out her comics elsewhere. It was about the production of a queer periodical. And so this one, here, that's the draft. So I went to her papers at Smith. This is the finished version. So the first panel is like, suck my dick, lick my clit, sodomy laws are full of shit. And so it's these young whippersnappers, one of who's a radical Sperry. They're sort of very involved in the production of the periodical. And they're sort of practicing their ACT UP demonstration slogan. And the sort of the older lesbian feminist, older people at the periodical are like thinking about sort of this intergenerational strife, right? And this is something that Bechdel's thinking about at the end of the 80s, because she sort of entered into feminist politics in media res at the beginning of the 80s. And then by the 90s, she's sort of one of these sort of older generation or approaching this sort of starting to feel this strife. And so she's putting this into the comic. It only goes on for 2 years. I'm not sure exactly why it ends. I haven't figured that out yet. Because it was successful, but I think she was thinking it was taking her away from Dykes, but she also, in 1990, becomes financially independent, and so is no longer working directly with periodicals. So I think there's some, you know, things to think about. Chris Kovic, her work is fantastic. If you don't know it, you should. One of her books you can get used is entitled What I Love About Lesbian Politics is Arguing with People I Agree With. Her work is really underrecognized. What you're seeing here are letters that she sent. She and Bechdel were pen pals for a long time, and so she'd send letters where she's annotating her comics and sort of giving her Bechdel more of the story of these comics. And her work circulated in various queer periodicals, including On Our Backs, which is a lesbian erotica magazine, Hot Wire, which is like lesbians and music magazine, just all over the place. So you know, definitely check it out. And then I'm going to talk about Jennifer Camper a little bit. So also worked in gay community news in the early 1980s. And this for me was an amazing find, because I had been reading letters from the beginning of gay comics, the series, and reading your like discussion of developing this strip, which was amazing to me. And then like seeing it here, and I'm thinking about like, how do we read, like in regular comics, we talk about like when comics get like anthologized, the loss of like readers' letters and advertisements, like when they become trades is something we think about. But when this becomes anthologized, we lose the conversation on the page in which it was first produced. How do we need to like think about comics discourse as reading this page as a comic itself, where the comic itself is but one panel in a larger frame that encompasses multiple conversations? How does a comic tie together or unite the frame? And so I'm gonna let you see it closer because it's great. These are the famous lesbian busts, including loves bowling alleys, never eats eggs, has six girlfriends, does it with Girl Scouts, never screams in public, hides out, and likes it in the shower. So I'm gonna end us there. Thank you.
Okay, so this is perfectly timed.
It's like we planned it.
Exactly. We are here to have a conversation with you guys, so we would love to take your questions about anything we talked about, our work, about queer comics generally.
We talked a lot about early superhero comics like X-Men, Wonder Woman, and how queer representation really was a lot of metaphor. And a lot of it could pass as just clean whatever, but if you knew that next level to look at, like we were almost in on what was really going on, and that added that subversive nature themes to it now. As comics are progressing now, you have more very out, you have same-sex marriage on the cover of the X-Men comic. You have all shades and variety of queer characters out, trans characters, that sort of thing, and being out there prominently as opposed to more down the layers, do you think there's do you lose some of that subversive nature, some of that mystique that we might have had with some of the earlier things we were talking about, that, especially for y'all's experience?
I want to read one quick thing, only because, wow, that's really loud. I didn't get a chance to do this, but I think it gives actually context to this conversation a little bit. We were talking about, as many people here were, being impacted by the X-Men and the Mutants, particularly in the 80s. And I just interviewed Chris Claremont last year, and it was a really extraordinary experience. And there were a lot of left-wing, I think, subversive writers working in comics exactly as Ramzi described. But what I think is interesting is those comics were created when the Comics Code Authority was in place. And I was thinking about this again in terms of morality building. Like, these characters meant so much to me. I think they actually inform my sense of ethics, my duty to the world. And yet, those characters were created under the constraints of this Comics Code Authority, which I just wanted to read because I think it's really fascinating. It was created in 1954. Mainstream superhero comics at the time, they had to have the seal of approval in order to sell their comics, and it had the following statutes. Crimes shall never be presented in such a way as to create sympathy for the criminal, or to promote distrust of the forces of law and justice, or to inspire others with a desire to imitate criminals. If crime is depicted, it shall be a sordid and unpleasant activity. Criminals shall not be presented so as to be rendered glamorous or to occupy a position which creates a desire for emulation. In every instance, good shall triumph over evil. In other words, restorative practices were literally outlawed in superhero universes. The only reason, I think this is really fascinating considering gay liberation, like literally was rooted in criminality, right? Like, and not necessarily because it was unjust or unethical, it was because there were laws that were, prohibiting activity, literally killing us. And so I wanted to talk to you about that and what your sort of take on its impact on the works that we love so much.
You mean gay liberation?
No, like particularly Comics Code Authority, and if thinking about its impact on content affected your interpretation of it.
Yeah, I mean, I think what we're talking about with something like the Comics Code Authority is working within a scene of constraint. So people within media studies will always talk about how something like the history of cinema, the Hays Code, which existed for so many decades, which was the similar code that like organized what could and could not be shown in film, many people would argue that the best movies that ever were produced in the history of Hollywood came out of that scene of constraint because people had to actually be creative within that scene. And now it's like you can see everything and everything's on display and we have like a glut of visual imagery, which becomes a mess at some level. But to answer your question, you know, I think I write about this very extensively. These, what you're talking about are two different strategies. There are different strategies of articulating or expressing difference. One is to actually represent difference directly. It's to say, like, here is a gay character, here's a transgender character. Another is to transform those identities or those differences into metaphors, mm-hmm. as you were saying, or into visual imagery or into scenarios. So the X-Men in the 70s may not have had a gay character, as I said, but many of the scenarios that they dealt with were incredibly queer, including, as I mentioned, like the formation of alternative kinships. One of the things I argue in my work is one of the things that's lost is that there is so much cultural capital placed on companies, which are considered to be traditionally conservative, to present actual differences, to say, like, here's a gay character, that when those companies do it, they don't feel that they have to do any other cultural work besides present this character to you. And see, we did what you wanted. Now the rest of the comic book can be racist or homophobic or whatever, but like there's like a Muslim character, so like you got what you wanted. So there's a give and take, and I think simply representing differences without an ethos or a worldview that is also committed to negotiating difference is meaningless, essentially. And what compels me about the period of the 70s in mainstream superhero comic books is that while you may not have always had direct representations of LGBT characters, you had characters who were incredibly heterogeneous. I think there's incredible diversity among those characters, like the X-Men, like the New Mutants. But they were also living their lives creatively in fictional universes that were committed to democratic and egalitarian engagement across difference. So there was like an ethic that was driving those comics, Claremont being like a prime example of that. And I think that that's often missing from contemporary mainstream superhero comic books.
Just to piggyback on that, going back to my initial questions of my own work about representation, what it means to be queer in a comic, and et cetera, and is it enough to have representation without transformation, without that character having a transformative quality in the world in which they exist? My friend Bobby and I talk about this all the time, particularly with racial representation. And is it enough to have, say, African-American characters lead the Avengers if they do nothing to make better in those universes the lives of other African-American characters, like tackling the, you know, prison industrial complex, whatever, how literally or metaphorically. If all they are doing is sort of buttressing the, you know, the world as it is, the visual representation I think matters. I mean, it does, but I question how effective they are as transformative figures if they're just doing what any other character could do.
And I also think, I mean, the question was about, are we losing subtext? And I think that we're always going to have subtext because even though we are telling some gay stories, there's so many stories we aren't telling.
Yeah. Yes.
So those kids are reading, you know, about whatever they're seeing now, but in you know, finding their own subtext of being, say, a transgender man who has a baby or mm-hmm. something that still isn't in these stories. So I think there will always be subtext.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I have to leave soon, but I yeah. wanted to just plan to see the intention on this wonderful panel. Being that so both educational as well as nurturing and validating, I happen to be an adjunct professor at Pace, mm-hmm. and which has a very active LGBT community. I think this would be an amazing, affirming experience for the students to have people like you come and address them. Yeah. That
Thank you. I mean, this is, I want to give Jen so much credit because I think Queers in Comics is kind of offering that, has been trying to offer that this last 4 years.
Yeah, I mean, we're trying to bring scholarship and comics together. And the reason I started the conference was because so many people were writing about queer cartooning and I realized they were going to get it wrong. So, I thought that, especially as our early LGBT cartoonists were now in their 60s and 70s, I really wanted their stories to be told. So everything at these conferences is being videotaped and archived. And, you know, I wanted to capture everybody's experiences before it was too late.
And I'm sure we'd be happy to visit.
We're all available for hire.
Hi, thank you all. Sort of the converse of reaching younger generation, I'm struck by, you know, I have a friend who's about my age who recently came out as a comic book fan, right?
What?
I was never in the closet. But as older people invested in comic book theater, I'm really struck by, I'm sorry, the second speaker, your comment about the pervasiveness of kind of militarism, but also just the, I think I can speak for a lot of, let's say, X-Men fans from the 80s who are simultaneously nostalgic for all the possibility of identification, misidentification, and kind of amazed, frustrated, and appalled by like the dominance of superhero narratives in popular culture broadly today, which actually should seem like it's transgressive but doesn't. You know, so what about like adults in comics, right? We're having this like the 60-year-old is still sort of involved in comics. Like, can we? I was interested in anyone on the panel was reflecting on the kind of transformational or political or subversive potential in comic book form for adult readers, right?
You know, that's something that's very peculiar to America, this idea that comics are for children.
Exactly.
You know, in Europe and in Asia, that's not such a concept. So yeah, I think there's plenty of old people doing comics, and now there's more and more old people doing comics about being old. Which is, we have actually a panel at the conference in April called Punk Rock Menopause, which is all about older lesbian cartoonists doing comics about aging. And I think you're going to see more and more of that.
I guess the question is not just about aging, but also aging and having a kind of more mature politics or relationship to...
I have several thoughts. I don't know if these actually are applicable, but one would be, I think, require consumers who are interested in being politically engaged through their entertainment, which I find the people I tend to engage with, say, in social media, half are and half are not. They see it as surface entertainment. I do not want to be engaged beyond that. In mainstream superhero comics, for them, the idea of superheroes and supervillains fighting, toppling a city, and starting all over is enough. Others are looking for that. So part of it, I think, is desire to be engaged, desire to engage the material on a deeper level than is presented. We've talked a little bit, I think it becomes more and more difficult in mainstream superhero comics with the corporatization of Marvel and DC even further, with those billion-dollar movie franchises, that there will be moments, I think, but I think it will be, based on discussions I've had behind the scenes, politicizing that material in any way, like overtly or subvertly, becomes very questionable because they're worried about losing money overseas, right? Like, so like that becomes a whole thing. So I am curious to see what will happen. I'm curious to see what consumers will demand from their entertainment, particularly queer consumers. I sort of sped through it, but again, is it just enough to see themselves in those universes that they fantasize about, or do they want to see themselves transforming the universes in which they fantasize about?
Can I add to this, actually? Because I wrote this article on Kitty Pride.
Oh!
I have a lot of affinity for Kitty Pride.
Yeah.
And you were talking about, like, politicizing, and I want to think about how the films are really depoliticized.
Yes, of course,
really
of course.
In really problematic ways. In, like, Days of Future Past, you take out the main character, who's Kitty Pride, and you replace her with Wolverine, and it becomes this, like, straight white men at the center, and all your marginal characters get pushed to the edges, and so you're like taking this like franchise that's all about like diversity and like internationalism, and you're just making it about white men.
Well, I you know
that's simplifying things.
Actually have the exact same read. I've said before last year when I was with you, I basically people asked me about the movies, and I was like, I shouldn't do as an academic, but I was like, I categorically think the movies are conservative.
Oh, yeah.
Radically conservative. And I've argued often that that's a formal problem.
Yeah.
That's because movies of this big budget are about visual spectacle.
Well, and a big part of it is that these films are made to be shown overseas because you don't need much language to understand these films.
Yeah, totally.
And so these are being marketed to an international audience, so they have to be bland enough to cover all cultures. Again, if you're looking for really good content, corporate art is not necessarily the place to find it.
Right. I think that's true. So again, to your question, what can young people look for in mainstream superhero comics? I think the future for me is a little hazy, particularly considering strangely, the financial success of these universes almost feels like prevents a lot of exactly what we're talking about.
But
I don't know if that's true.
Part of what Tavia was, you were asking also, like, what is the payoff for adult readers at this point of comics? And I think that we're seeing adult readers struggling, and that struggle is symptomatic of the way we study comics. So what I mean by that is that, like, adult readers, I think one of the payoffs of reading comics is that it's one of those mediums that, because it unfolds serially, it can outlive you. So, like, comics, like, you can grow up with comics.
Yep.
You know, you can read Alison Bechdel's work when you were 21 and be like, oh, I grew up with her as a lesbian in all of these decades, and I'm watching her characters grow. So there's a way in which comics also have the payoff of longevity. And I think contemporary superhero comic books don't have longevity. Like, the Fantastic Four outlived many of its readers. Like, people could have, like, read it when they were kids and died, and the comic kept moving on. But now they're canceling all those series. So I think what we see, the way that we see adults struggling to make meaning of it is, one, they're leaving the superhero genre.
Yep.
And so they have nostalgia for, like, the 60s and 70s, and all that stuff is being reprinted. So adults love to buy all that old stuff and read it because it's so, like, radical and fascinating and visually beautiful. I think we see people, like, one problem in academic scholarship is that it's so weighted towards independent comics. So, like, the fact that when I wrote my book, it was considered, like, one of the only and first major cultural studies, like, from a major university press of superhero comic books is odd, because it's, like, the most mainstream genre, but people, while independent comic books are very underrepresented in, like, the industry, they're overrepresented in academic scholarship. And so what we see is, like, a lot of adults, like, making independent comics, like, the fetish of comics, and saying, like, well, I don't read the trash. Like, I read the good stuff. And this is where we see the debates about graphic novels. Like we have to elevate the medium, yeah, and et cetera. So I think that you can tell what is the payoff for adult readers today by the symptomatic struggles they have in, like, figuring out what to read in the medium.
Yeah.
Like, really, I think that that's how we see it, is that they miss what they used to have and they're struggling to find the genres. And the last thing I'll say is the rise of auteurs. So the fact that people no longer read series, they read particular authors. They're like, I only read Grant Morrison. Or, like, I only read this person. That's another thing where adult readers are saying, like, I used to read widely in everything. Now everything is, like, commercial art, so, like, I only read the work of this artist or this writer. And so I think that's, I don't know if that answers that, but.
Yes.
Yeah. And then.
So there have been trans cartoonists and writers for decades in the underground scene, but there was a time in the 90s where it seemed like a lot were breaking in between Rachel Pollack, Caitlin R. Kiernan, Maddie Blaustein. You had Neil Gaiman and Grant Morrison writing trans characters. And then around 2001, that all came to a halt. Hmm. And then it was only very recently, in the last year or two, we've seen Tamara Bond villain, Max Asagio, Leela Sturgis. And I'm just wondering if you might be able to comment or bring some of your insights in on how it seemed like there was more trans acceptance in comics in the 90s, and then how it just sort of crashed down, and now it's coming back up again, and how it sort of went up and down.
I don't have a lot of insight. The thing that strikes me, what you're talking about, though, is 2001. My experience, at least at DC Comics, and a little bit Marvel, was that the politics of comic storytelling changed 9/11. Also, I think as Vertigo transformed, Vertigo being DC's comics adult imprint, the sort of material they were creating, et cetera. I'm babbling because I'm not sure I actually have a great answer for you. But my sense is the politics of the world, the politics of the states, and the politics of the people in charge as leadership shifted, as focus shifted, particularly over the, from about, I would say, 2004 to 2012, DC Comics began planning its sort of cross-country move to become a larger entertainment conglomerate. I also think that the mainstream superhero comics remain remarkably, like, there's a lot of nepotism. So much of getting a job is who you know, or being in the job for really, like, I think I work because I'm terrible in terms of deadlines. I think I work because people know me and they know what they're going to get, right? And so, and as the industry has become more and more conservative, more corporate owned, they want guarantees. So some lip service is paid to hiring people who do not look like the people that have always worked in that, in those companies. My guess though is it's easier and quicker to hire people that they know, that they're like, okay, he's a 35,000, let's put him on the book. I don't know if that's true, but that's my sense, is it's people who are in control, the politics of those people, continued corporatization by studios of the industry, nepotism, interest. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
I mean, that's a good question. Somebody over here, and then we can move on.
Yeah, I have a question for Maggie. Okay. So sort of talking about just having these conversations in general and how it's playing out in the academy. Because you're at the University of Wisconsin, correct?
No.
I am.
Oh, okay. So,
but also an academic.
I mean, I'm at CUNY, so
okay,
we have...
So, but both of you can.
I would say that we have become the epicenter of like the crisis of higher education.
Wow. They began with the anti-union rhetoric.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, what are you finding in the classroom? Sort of like neoliberal practices of corporations that can come in and say, we're not going to fund you if you have this type of ideology down the syllabus.
Yeah. I know that we can both talk about this.
Yeah.
But since you just mentioned UW-Madison, I mean, I think something that's very heartening about Madison is that after a very intense, so if people don't know, like UW-Madison is a school that's been going through a prolonged crisis. It's like one of the first universities, like major public universities in the country, to have its tenure rules transformed. It's so that tenure has been weakened at the university, and it is considered like the Berkeley of the Midwest. So the weakening of tenure at a major internationally renowned public university is very scary. We've been massively defunded by the state governorship under Scott Walker. And there have been a series of kind of very public, you might have seen it in the news, where people syllabize, usually adjunct professors, which is particularly heinous. Like, I mean, all my classes are literally like sex, 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 and culture. And I've never been attacked publicly for anything that I've been doing. And it's partly because I'm protected by a very powerful English department that supports what I'm doing. So there have been a couple of professors who've been attacked publicly for what they're teaching. Like, we have this class on called The Problem with Whiteness. And somehow, like, a state senator heard about this and seems to have thought that whiteness studies just was invented 7 months ago. and like threw a fit, et cetera, and whatever. And but I will say, after a period of morale loss at the university, the school has basically closed ranks and is fighting the fight. Like, it's amazing. People are actually being more radical about what they're teaching. And part of the way they're making the argument is in neoliberal terms, they're saying when you teach radical classes, students sign up for them. So like, by the way, you wanted to fill seats. Like, you call a class American Sex Cultures and people are gonna fill the seats. So like, you call a class The Problem with Whiteness and a lot of students of color who hate most of their classes are gonna take the class because like they wanna be seen and heard. So I think that there is a huge pushback. I know my department has supported everything that I do, and I'm actually just teaching more, like, I changed the name of one of my classes so it's called Gay is Good, Queer Visions of Freedom, like since the 70s. And I wanted to let queer students know, like, by the way, this class is for you. Like, by the way, everybody else, like, if you want to, fine, but like, this is for you guys. And so I think that, and comics are at the center of that. You know, we have Linda Berry at our university. She's been hired like permanently. But again, it's this double-edged sword. Like, by having Linda Berry, there is something neoliberal about that. The school's like, we have this brilliant, feminist comics artist, like at the Wisconsin Institute for Learning, and she teaches these workshops and everyone signs up for them. And it's very much this model of like comics puts people in seats and people spend money on it. But at the same time, like once they're in those seats, she radicalizes them. So like there is, people are playing with and against the system. And there is no way that UW-Madison is going to survive these massive budget cuts without becoming corporatized. It's just not, it's not possible. So a purist politics where we imagine that the school is going to escape this totally is not viable. But I think the school is really, really fighting back through its teaching. Yeah. And comics are like central to that.
Okay, so I guess I have to take a different angle
on
this. Sure. I mean, I think one thing to think about structurally about comics within academia is it's not really a field that gets hired in explicitly right now. And so the people who teach comics are often part-time people, or they're people who have a primary research area in something else, and then they teach comics on the side. And that shapes and perverts the field in really weird ways. And there are a generation of people like myself who are like, fuck it, I'm just gonna be a comic scholar. I do other things too, but this is the thing that I'm committing to. This is the center of my work. And it's not easy to find a job necessarily, but it is easy to get things like, there's a lot of publishing happening right now in a comics. It's easy to get a book contract, but getting a job when they already have someone who teaches comics who's part-time and precarious, and that's a problem, that this field is a part-timer's field or it's a field of someone's hobby. That's something that we need to think about, and how that sort of shapes or, you know, deforms our field.
That's actually such a good point, because also, I mean, this is the double-edged sword of what you're saying, this neoliberalization, which a term that we're using to simply describe like the transformation of all academic processes to like the production of profit and capital. One of the double-edged swords of comics is what you were just saying, which is that schools don't hire explicitly in comics, but they have a fetish for people who teach about comics and also make them. Because they love to be like, look, like this person's gonna teach people how to make comics too, and then like we'll make money off of that. And so you have this really odd thing with where some people, like Linda Berry, like John Jennings, who's like probably the most important African-American scholar and producer of comics today, who is a genius and like is amazing, but like UC Riverside actively recruited him because they also want someone who both studies and produces comics. So in that sense, that neoliberal logic produces something really good, which is like the radicalizing of these departments, which were already, I mean, UC Riverside is already like really like very radical and very brilliant. But so we see these weird formations that Maggie is describing, where the field is like having a zeitgeist, or like it's so hot right now to write about comics.
So hot.
Like it's like everybody's like, oh, you figured it out. And we're just like, we just love this stuff.
And it's like, let us give you a book contract because we haven't published yet on comics.
Exactly, exactly. Yes. So, and yet, like you said, like that'll happen and then people will be like, we're not giving you jobs. Like it's like a weird, it's a very,
it's a bizarre field.
Yeah. Were you gonna ask a question and then we'll have,
I'm pretty much contemporary with you two, and I grew up with my morality and basically my life was shaped and my hard times with good times with New Mutants, Teen Titans, Wonder Woman shaped me. I'm Puerto Rican, so I live in a place where most of the college graduates are women. Everything's run by women. There are 10 women to each guy, so the guys pretty much have to be the guy either to get a job. Every woman has the job already. And I went through 3 wars. I'm 25-year-plus retired soldier. And I participated in the Gulf War this past, after 9/11. And yes, I go to the Independent Medium and I buy his stuff. We're cousins. But all those secret wars, war this, war that, I don't buy those. It's gotten so corporate that you have 20 X-Men series going on, 10 Avengers series going on. So I go to independent comics a lot. And I've been drawing since I was a kid. So I buy for the artists, but the art could be terrible. It could be kindergarten, but if it has good story, I will always buy that comic. I will always choose good story and context over visual art. And I hardly ever buy other artists' art, because if I want a poster or a painting, I can do that myself. So, but I buy your stuff.
Well, thank you.
Buy your stuff. I said, the, everything that's going on with the war and what he said, yeah, after 9/11, in the industry, everything shifted. It was basically, let's support the war. Bush is our president, and we're making a lot of money, especially the Cubans.
Didn't...
I'm not gay, but my younger brother is, and so is my foster son.
Didn't Disney take over Marvel in 2004?
It did,
yes,
yeah.
It did.
For $4 billion.
Yep.
Mm. Were you... Let's take a couple more questions, I think, before we wrap up. And
sure.
Then, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, the only problem I have is, like, a lot of comic books, when they're translated into this big international movie series, they lose that message behind the comic book, and, like, I watch the movie, and I'm like, that was not in the freaking comic book. You messed up the scene, or, like, that scene's not in there. So, like, how do you feel, like, the message, especially when the queer population uses comic books to send it out to other populations and to reach out to people, like, how do you feel that can be lost?
When it comes to the Wonder Woman movie specifically, because I know people involved and I'm really fond of the director, I'm sort of tempering my reaction to it until I see it. The thing that strikes me, though, and I think is that what is important to me and what was transformative to me about Wonder Woman, the messaging came from her earlier incarnations, I would say the 1940 stuff, which is actually, as a teenager, I eschewed, and as an adult, I completely embraced, almost reversing the my love for which iteration, right? So like the George Perez version, which I showed, was profoundly impactful to me when I was 16. As an adult, it is much less important to me because I find it much less transgressive than the 1940 stuff, especially contextualizing at the time, and its messaging. I don't believe for a minute that that messaging is going to end up in the Wonder Woman movie. I think it's going to be a fairly basic, she's a creature of hope and compassion and, you know, love, et cetera, and she'll use a sword, she'll cut things up. And I don't expect much from that movie in terms of transformative politics. Conversely, what I think is really interesting is that character meant so much to me, particularly her queerness, that when I talk to other queer people, particularly gay men, about it, particularly gay men of a generation, I'm awed at how they don't care about that stuff at all. I have a friend, all he cares about is if she's gonna fly in the movie. I have another friend that, like, she better spin. I'm like, if she's not gonna spin, it's not gonna happen. Well, she better fucking spin. I'm like, well, what about this, what about this? They don't care. And what I have struggled, particularly as a queer, you know, queer creator, and someone who really sort of embraces what I believe are the potential for the potential for transgressive political messaging in comics, I'm awed by the number of my friends who just don't care about that, who are lifelong Wonder Woman fans, but they are so excited about their love of this character being legitimized by a big scale $100 million movie, that when we talk about the components that will probably be gone, they're like, yeah, it's really terrible, but she's getting her own movie. Like, somehow the idea that $100 million, like, I use that figure, but this character that they've loved since a child, who's usually shit upon, reviled, et cetera, mocked, is suddenly getting a serious movie, and it will be seen by people on multiple continents. She's being taken seriously, legitimately, no matter what's changed, like, in that process. That seems to be more important than any particular messaging.
Also, one thing to keep in mind is that when, as creators, if you work for Marvel or DC, you don't own anything that you, I mean, you know, you, it's work for hire. So there's a corporation that owns these characters,
yep,
that own the Bible, that own the story. And we all know many people who have created characters that have been taken away and destroyed in the movies. Mm-hmm. So there's not a lot of authorship in these films in terms of, you know, one person's viewpoint.
Let's take both of these questions at once.
This is, oh my God.
I'm a master of this. You know this, I'm a master.
Go, 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 go.
Did Do you want to ask your question, and then we'll take this one, and we'll combine them, and then that will be our, like, final, yeah.
Okay, I have a question about diversity and corporatization. I grew up on comics on X-Men, and you were talking earlier about the diversity of the group, and I remember that, like, Thunderbird, like, died right away, and then the other Japanese, I don't even remember his name.
Sunfire. He just went back to Japan.
Well, he defects from the team and he goes back to Japan. Yeah.
Okay. So then, for a while, there weren't any brown characters. We had
Storm.
Well, we had Storm and, like, Nightcrawler.
They're actually, like...
very black because he's dark skin.
Yeah.
And then, after that, we didn't get anybody for, like, a while. I mean, all I'm saying is, like, there's been, like, a smattering of brown characters throughout the time. Like,
Let's take the we have so much to say.
We have much to say about that.
I'm sorry.
My question is, I feel like it's ironic that in a land the metaphor is not lost on me that it's people of color are like disenfranchised, and then mutants
the metaphor.
Why? Feel like there's like a fear in the corporate world to depict that literally, because I feel like there haven't been that many. I mean, there have been more over the years.
Depict what literally? People
like,
of color?
Yeah.
People of color as mutants.
That's a great question.
Literal for people. Yeah. I mean, does the corporate, you talk about the corporate world as conservative, like,
yeah.
They not want to face that, maybe they think that people of color are mutants. That's my question.
I can't live up to that question. My question is much more basic, especially with comics coming out that are like more queer than ever. Is there anything you guys have read recently that runs parallel to anything you're working on, or that has sort of echoed the basic comic that you read growing up that made you go like this is amazing. Mm-hmm. I want to like be very different. Yeah.
Those are both so good. Do you want?
I say go, how about it?
So this is actually what my book is basically about, I'll just say, like everything you just talked about. This is where my dear colleague, who you should all read his book, Andre Carrington, who wrote this amazing book called Speculative Blackness, The Future of Race in Science Fiction. He and I like overlap in a lot of ways, but we also disagree in a lot of ways. He thinks the use of metaphors like mutation to talk about race are kind of irritating. And he's interested in like what happens when actual black bodies appear in comics. He has an amazing chapter on Storm, a chapter on Uhura in Star Trek. And I disagree with him because I think that's totally important and valuable that actual black bodies and actual gay people appear. But I think there's incredible power in metaphors because they allow you to cognitively make leaps from your own experience to the experience of otherness more broadly. What intrigues me about the X-Men is that while mutation is an elastic metaphor for many kinds of difference, like being a mutant could be like being gay or being black or being this or whatever, at distinct historical moments, it's been something specific. So like I argue that in the 70s, it looked like race because the team was so international. They come from so many different racial and ethnic backgrounds, but really it was about sexuality and gender. This was like my argument. And that at each historical moment, the comic books are articulating or linking a metaphor like mutation to particular differences. So I'm very generous to these comics. Like one way to answer your question is like the reason there's not that many brown people is because of racism. Because it's just like the industry is racist and it's like there is a long history of not representing a vast diversity of people. On the other hand, there was a kind of relentless diversity about Marvel Comics in the 70s and 80s. Like the X-Men that you're describing in the 70s, they may not have had a ton of brown bodies, but like every member came from a different country. Every single one. The New Mutants has an indigenous character, has a Native American character.
And yet, the creators were mostly straight white men. And I think that things will not change until we have more people of color, women, and queer creators.
Yeah.
And I think even though you might have had a certain amount of stuff in the 70s, multicultural, it was hip to have, it still was being created by white people.
I think that's true. But see, this is where Justin Hall and you like disagree or argue, which is like, I think that's 100% unquestionably true. But fans found so much meaning in those characters. Mm-hmm. Like they didn't
fans obviously worried about the lack of diversity in comics, but they also took what they got and they did so much with it.
Yeah, I'm not saying, I mean, I think those characters were important. I'm just saying that moving forward, it's not until the creators are different kinds of people that you're going to get those other kinds of stories.
And I'm just going to put this in interesting economic terms. Actually thinking about today, so one of the things that, and this is when we're, starting over. One thing was really interesting, talk about diversity in comics, is what we're talking about. We're talking about racial, ethnic, sexual, gender, economic diversity. One of the things, for example, that we loved about the New Mutants, which just that team still blows my mind, in terms of its diversity, not only for the countries from which those characters came, but its economic diversity, right? Like you had the super poor to the super rich on this one team, and that's extraordinary. And the super poor guy was a white guy, and the super rich guy was a brown-skinned Brazilian. Like that, in and of itself, especially in 1984, contextualizing the time in which this was made, I remember was profound to me. That said, I don't disagree with your assessment. One thing, though, that we find in, and I think there are a lot of reasons for this, is despite, and I'm framing this as a queer thing now, more than about people of color, but there are a huge number of fans into comics and comic characters, particularly interested in queer content in mainstream superhero books. They don't buy it. And they read about it, they Tumblr about it, they blog about it, they don't buy it. And I say this, and all of you might disagree with me, but my experience in the industry, it is highly reactive to consumption. Like, if people buy something a lot, they're going to put out more of it. And so I find that we're in this catch-22 in terms of representation and diversity. Because there are, right, for example, Marvel Comics right now, there's a lot of hoo-ha being thrown at them because of how they are reinterpreting and transforming their characters in ways that make them 1,000 times more fascinating to me than they've ever been. However, lots of pushback. People are talking about them. Sales continue to be rocky for a variety of reasons. Distribution, they're really expensive, a bunch of things. So one of the impediments I see to true transformation, again, is A, looking to see ourselves specifically in corporate comics, which, again, I think we're worlds, particularly DC, but even to some extent Marvel, that were built not really to showcase us. And like demanding that we be seen in those worlds is a really interesting thing. I think their corporate nature and the fact that they are billion-dollar brands is like a component of that, but also people want to see themselves reflected in these books and want to see themselves as creators of these books. I don't know how to say this.
You know, that's the perfect segue to your question, because I just am putting together the lineup for the next Queers in Comics. We have over 150 LGBT cartoonists. Back in the day, the early comics by most queer people was coming out autobiography, right, memoir.
Yep.
Right now, all the young kids coming up are doing spec fic, sci-fi, and fantasy. So I see the change now. And when you ask what's there to read out there, whatever you want.
Oh,
really.
For sure.
Now, there are so much LGBT comics, both in the U.S. and internationally. There's exciting stuff happening, not just in Europe and Asia, but in the Middle East, in South America. I mean, all over, people are doing really interesting things. So now it's not just what's good queer comics. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, do you want queer robots?
Right.
Do you want a heartfelt coming out story in Thailand? It's really across the board now. So, I mean, if you just want to see what our list is, go to our website and you can see 154 queer cartoonists that are going to be at the conference.
Also, FlameCon, which happens
in
New York, and then
FlameCon is in the summer. It's a queer comics convention.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome. But so, like, putting these two questions together, I got some thoughts here. People to read about, especially like Deborah Whaley's Black Women in Sequence, great book. Jonathan Gray is finishing up a book called Illustrating the Race, that's just going to be forthcoming soon. Also, in a different vein, I really love Mimi Thi Nguyen's work on race and zines. I think zines and their relationships with comics don't get enough talking about. But in terms of like new work, I'm all into new work, but I'm also into this idea of queers are always going into libraries to learn about who they are. And so I would encourage you to go to the Lesbian History Archives here in Brooklyn, to go to the Interference Archives in Brooklyn, to go to ABC No Rio, except that they're changing spaces. I spent yesterday in New York Public Library looking at the LGBT periodicals collection. There's a bunch of stuff in the microform room, and you get to learn how to use old technologies, which is great. Online, there's the Queer Zine Archive Project, which has a lot of comics in it. There's a People of Color Zine Project. There's just a lot of stuff, and the stuff, the things that you're reading in the 80s, you realize how much is left unresolved. So I'm like reading World War III Illustrated, a long-running political comic series, and so much of it resonates with Black Lives Matter and the concerns we have today about police violence and race. And so, you know, I would encourage you to read all, to go and see this list of all these new cartoonists, but also to go back to these roots, especially because we don't know what these roots are, and we haven't fully synthesized them and built upon these roots.
I'm just also
Columbia. Please go to Columbia. And Karen Green's gonna kill me. I was gonna not mention you because I didn't know if you wanted the shout out, but Columbia has a number of creators' archives that are in the process of being processed right now. Howard Cruz's work, the Kitchen Sink Press archives, which are fabulous because they have both the letters and the responses. They have the full constellation of correspondence, which is just impossible. And so you could sit and read these words from the past about creators talking about their work and their process, which is just fantastic.
One other thing I just want to say, and it continues to be my experience, although it is changing, that genre fans tend to love their genre. And one of the things I still see resistance to, particularly among queer readers, is crossover. People who read comics as a medium and who think about that kind of narrative as a thing to collect, they tend to be genre specific. Not always, I'm talking mass generalities, but I think this is one of those impediments to seeing ourselves represented in ways when people are like, well, I can't see myself in comics, it means you can't see yourself in X-Force, not necessarily in comics as a medium. And I just think that I think it is worth reminding people that as we've been talking about, there are hundreds of possibilities to see ourselves reflected quite succinctly in this medium. But the genre fans, I think, have a harder time with that, letting go. And part of that is I'm a genre fan. Like I sought out a certain kind of comic because I was interested in fantastical narrative. I love that, I still do. But as I've gotten older, my interests have expanded, and I'm really glad that they have, because I can see the different kinds of storytelling out there. I don't know if it's grown exponentially, but certainly my interest in it has grown exponentionally.
Can we take one more?
Okay.
You went by the different archives so fast, I was trying to type them. So Lesbian Queer Archives, Columbia.
Lesbian History Archives, in Brooklyn. Interference Archives in Gowanus. ABC No Rio, they're currently looking for a new space. QZAP. Queer Zine Archive Project, that's online. They're based in Milwaukee. People of Color Zine Project, and also Columbia has some fantastic archives that they're collecting.
Barnard Zine.
Brooklyn College has a zine collection too.
There's also a queer cartoonist database online that cross-references people who are queer, people of color, whatever. So it's all just lists of cartoonists.
If you hit me up on Twitter, I can.
No, we're happy to give you emails.
Yes.
Exist. And Jen's work and Phil's work and my work are in the back if you want signed things. This has been so wonderful. Thank you all so much.
Thank you.